So for those who heard my talk last time, this will be a different talk, obviously, but different also in what I want to speak about. Last time I gave a general introduction to self-organizing systems, which means that I was emphasizing what we know about self-organization, or at least what I understand about self-organization. Now I'm basically going to talk about the things we don't yet know about self-organization, but things that are particularly important if we want to tackle the problem of engineering self-organizing systems. So in my view, as I will try to explain here, the biggest problem is the problem of coordination. So let's explain what I mean. Just very quickly, a reminder of what is self-organization. I define self-organization as the spontaneous appearance of order or organization. Spontaneous meaning that it is not imposed by some outside or inside agent. The spontaneous appearance out of local interaction. So it's often used with the phrase global order from local interactions. You have many components that interact locally one by one. Out of that, the whole system organizes. That means that you now get an organization that is distributed over all the components. That means it's not centralized, it's not localized, it's everywhere. So you have an order that is collective and that also has a kind of robustness that you would not find in centralized systems. Now, in my approach to self-organizing systems, I always look at two levels, the global level of the system, the local level of the components and the interactions. And these components I call agents. So an agent is an elementary component of the system. Depending on the system, that could be a molecule, it could be a person, it could be an animal, like the typical examples of social insects such as ants. It could be a robot, or in the cases that we are interested in, self-organizing engineered systems, these components, these agents, could be some technical components. They could be robots, sensors, software modules. So what does an agent do? By definition of an agent, it's something that acts. It performs actions. It acts on its environment. It will act not just like that. It will act typically in response to something it senses. So the agent senses the state of the environment. In response, the agent acts. Agents typically are goal-directed, but we must say that the goal may be explicit or may be implicit. In the most general terms, the goal is implicit. That means that the agent does not know what it wants to get, but its actions lead to what is called in dynamical systems an attractor state, or what in evolutionary systems we might call a high fitness state. That means the actions of the agents have some kind of a preference, an inbuilt preference for a certain type of state. So if you leave the agent to act for long time enough, it will move towards this attractor state, this goal state. Now, as all systems, agents can be conceptualized very simply as a kind of a black box. A black box means something with an input. Inside the black box, something happens with that input. The result is something else that comes out, the output. The input in general is the state of the environment as the agent perceives it. The agent then performs an action. It does something with that state. The result is that a new state of the environment is produced. And the agent is what processes, what transforms the one into the other. So these are my components of my self-organizing systems. Now I need to build the system itself. So what is this self-organizing system? First of all, it's a collection of many of these agents, but it's not just a collection, it's a network, it's a system of interaction. So the important thing I need here to build my self-organizing system is interaction. And how does interaction take place? It's trivial, it's spontaneous. An agent acts in response to its environment. It senses the environment. It performs an action that creates a new state of the environment. This new state of the environment will be sensed by the other agents in the neighborhood, which means that these agents typically will, in response, also perform an action. This new action will again change something in the environment, which will in turn trigger some other agents further to perform an action. So what you typically get is that something happens somewhere in the system that makes one or more agent act, these actions then kind of propagate in a kind of a cascade of activities. This cascade propagates throughout the system and sooner or later will come to some equilibrium, to some kind of an attractor state. So again, the system has an inbuilt, implicit goal, namely the attractor of the global dynamics. I have a goal at the level of the agent. I have a goal at the level of the collection of the agent. The goal at the level of the collection of agents is the attractor of the global dynamics. It's easy to formulate it like that. It's not at all easy to know what that global attractor will be starting from the local attractor. So it's a non-trivial problem. That is the problem of self-organization. You have agents with their local goals, their local attractors. You put them together, you let them interact. Out of that interaction, some global attractor emerges. What will be that global attractor? In general, you can't tell until you do the experiment. Now, what we are going towards is engineering systems. And an engineered system is a system that was built for a particular purpose. That means it's a system that we expect to perform a function. The first task we have to do if we want to explain engineering systems is to define a function of a system. And I have a very simple definition. It's not original. It's something that from time to time appears in the literature on cybernetics. And that is that the function of a system is simply what the system does. Systems behave in a certain way. They do certain things. If we see that they always tend to behave in the same way, no matter what perturbations or what the situations, if we see that they robustly tend to always go towards the same kind of behavior, then we call that the function of the system. The function of the system is, in a sense, what this inbuilt goal, this implicit goal of the system is. So in that sense, a self-organizing system has its own function, its own purpose. The fact that it is self-organizing creates its own function. So what the system does, it is, as I said, transforming input into output. If we want to do it mathematically, we can define a function, an input-output function, which in the simplest case goes from an input to an output. In a slightly more complicated case, we will also need to take into account the internal state of the system. It does this thing robustly. By robustly, I mean that this behavior is stable. It's to some degree invariant. If I perturb the system, it may move away from its habitual way of behavior, but after a while, it will move back to this behavior. So there is the idea that the system is in some kind of an attractor, is in some kind of a stable equilibrium, and if you perturb it, if you push it away from that, it will return to it. So that, for me, is the function of a system. The problem of engineering now is, of course, that we don't want the system just to perform anything it likes. We don't want to the system to behave just as the system would like to behave. We want the system to behave in the way that we would like. That's to say, we want to somehow control this function. On the other hand, because we're speaking about self-organizing system, this function is emergent. That means that, as I said in the beginning, you don't know, starting from the local dynamics of the agents, you don't know what the global dynamics will be. You let the agents interact. Out of the interaction, some global attractor, therefore a global function emerges. You don't know, in general, what that will be. So that is the first and the major problem of self-organization. So let's try to analyze this problem in a little bit more depth to understand what we can do about it. So we would like the system to behave in a certain way. We would like it to perform a particular function. I have defined the function in most general terms as the transformation of some input state into some output state. We, as outside designers of the system, we want to control that system, we want it to do something useful, so we can conceptualize it in the following way. The input state, the beginning state, that is our problem state. That is a state where something is not the way we would like it to be. So the system starts with an initial situation or an initial information that it gets. And we want the system to deal with that situation. It should somehow tackle the problem, solve the problem, do something so that things get better. The output of the system ideally is a solution to the problem. So ideally we would like the output to be a new situation where now whatever thing was wrong in the beginning has disappeared and things are the way we want them to be. So the output we can conceptualize as a solution to the problem, the answer to our query, the changed situation that resolves the conflicts or problems or whatever there was. A simple example, one of the most well-known engineered self-organizing systems, that's a neural network. In a neural network, what you typically do is you give it some input. For example, you give it an array of pixels that are either black or white. You let the neural network work on these pixels, it processes these pixels, and it comes out with, hopefully, a recognition of the pattern that's in those pixels. It tells you which letters these are, or which numbers, or which geometrical figures. So that's how we can conceptualize, in the most general terms, the idea of a function that the system performs for us. Now we are back to the main problem. How can we make the system perform that function for us? So, a self-organizing system is a collection of interacting agents. We have some idea of the function we want the system to perform. Like in the case of the neural network, we know here is a bunch of pixels and here is the letter that is to be recognized. So we have some idea of how the solution should look. As designers of the systems, we normally have some control over the agents themselves. I was speaking about agents that are kind of technological systems, modules, robots, sensors. So we have some control over how each individual agent functions. On the other hand, what we don't have control over is how the agents will interact. If we had control over how the agents would interact, it would not be a self-organizing system. It would be an ordinary design system. And we know what are the shortcomings of ordinary design systems. First, complexity. It's very difficult to design all the interactions correctly. Second, robustness. Whenever something goes wrong, engineered systems cannot deal with it. And third, an engineered system will never be as creative as a self-organizing system. So we would like somehow to have control over the agents, to have control over the function that the global system performs, but we don't want to have control over the way the agents interact. The agents themselves should somehow discover what is the best way of interacting so as to perform the function. So what are the problems then we need to tackle? We need to impose somehow the function. Since the function is a global function, it's a function that tells you this is the global input, this kind of global output is what I would like to be, we have to somehow impose that on the system. That is what I call the problem of training. We will somehow have to give the system some signals to tell it that it's doing well or that it's not doing well. The second problem, and that's the problem I want to concentrate on in this talk, it's the problem of getting the agents to interact in an efficient, effective way. That is what I will call the problem of coordination. The problem of training, it's something that's relatively well known. There are two major approaches which are actually pretty similar. It's the approaches in evolutionary systems, like, for example, genetic algorithms. What you do is you define a fitness function. You create something in the system so that either the agents or the interactions can undergo many different variations. You test whether a particular variation is fit or not fit. If it is fit, you retain it and possibly multiply that type of agent or that type of interaction. If it's not fit, you eliminate it. That's a very generic, very well-known method. The other approach is the approach that's more used in neural networks and learning systems. It's what we might call in general reinforcement. You have a system that, again, is able to some degree of variation. There can be certain types of interactions, let's say, activation propagating along certain links rather than other links. If that gives a good result, you reward the behavior, you strengthen it, you reinforce it. If it doesn't give a good result, you punish it. That means you weaken it, you inhibit it. Both methods basically are the same approach, that is rewarding good behavior, suppressing bad behavior. That is easy enough if your system is, let's say, a one-level system. In the case of evolutionary algorithms, if you have a single agent that should perform a function, you can just try out millions and millions of different forms, variations of that agent until you find one that does exactly what you do. You can do that via many different generations by applying your fitness function. That's relatively simple. What we are interested in is not a single agent, we are interested in a collection of many interacting agents, and then we get to the problem of complexity. That is that a problem, the problem that our system solves, will typically be solved via many steps, different agents doing different tasks at different moments, passing on the provisional results to next agents. So we get a kind of a network of interactions there. At the end, hopefully we get something that resembles a solution. We can give then a reward, but the problem is, to whom do we give the reward? There are many different agents who contributed to that solution. It's not obvious which agent has contributed positively, which agent has maybe even contributed negatively. There again is a kind of an existing generic solution, which is called backpropagation, at least in neural networks, and the idea is your problem solution goes through many different stages. At the end, it's delivered by some agents, typically the output layer of neurons in a neural network. You reward the agent that delivered a good solution, but then you expect that this agent somehow passes back the reward to the agents that gave it the provisional solution. So, because no agent can solve the problem alone, you only can reward the last ones because it's at the last stage that you know whether the solution is good or not, and then you expect these agents somehow to propagate back the reward to the previous agents. So this is used in neural networks. It's used also in a system that I will mention later. It's a system developed by John Holland, which is called classifier systems, which is a more evolutionary system based on what is called the bucket brigade algorithm, where you have rules that together solve a problem, and then the rules that provided the right solution kind of give back via a so-called bucket brigade the reward they got to previous agents. It's also used in something I will also mention a little bit later, the jack-in-the-nut self-organizing agent system. So to quickly illustrate the idea, this is my self-organizing system. These are the different agents. An agent gets some input, passes on some of that to other agents who do further things with it. At the end, I get the system output. In between are all kind of possible configurations of interactions between the agents. Suppose that these two agents have given me a good solution. I reward them. The reward is here shown by an orange color. What they do is they give back the reward to the ones that this agent received a solution from this agent, so he gives back the reward. He gives back the reward. The reward propagates back until all the agents hopefully have gotten what they deserved. Sounds simple? It's not so simple. It's not so simple, especially if we are not working in a neural network. The simplest type of neural networks, so-called feed-forward networks, are organized in layers, and you have an input layer, a number of so-called hidden layers, and an output layer, and there's a very clear ordering. Start at the input layer, go to the next layer, and finally to the output layer. So backpropagation is very easy. You start by rewarding the last layer, and that propagates back to the previous layer, to the previous layer, and so on. It's very simple. In a self-organizing system in general, it's not that simple. In a self-organizing system in general, we can assume that the network of interactions between the agents will be variable. That means that there are no fixed connections. Sometimes one agent may pass information to another agent. Sometimes it passes on to a different agent. So the geometry is variable. It's not trivial. It's not obvious how you do the backpropagation. And why am I interested in these kind of more complex systems? Because I want something which, by lack of a better word, I call intelligent self-organization. There are simple forms of self-organization. There are more complicated, more intelligent, more sophisticated forms of self-organization. And here I'm looking at the intelligent ones. So I want different agents to be able to do different things in different moments. So what I really want is collective intelligence, yeah, and that's always a problem I have when I put it on a non-Macintosh thing, but those pictures are not important. So collective intelligence, I think you all know about it. It's simply the idea that if you have many agents, each of which is relatively stupid, together they may still be smart. And a nice approach of that is a book by James Surowiecki that is called The Wisdom of Crowds. And the best part of his work is that he gives us a summary of requirements for collective intelligence. And these requirements are four.
Can you show this again?
The name, The Wisdom of Crowds by James Surowiecki. So his four requirements for collective intelligence are, first, diversity. If all the agents are exactly the same, they know the same, they can do the same things together, they cannot be more intelligent than alone. The information they have is simply the same, so the sum of 100 times the same information is still the same information. So what you want ideally is that your agents are as diverse as possible, have different experiences, have access to different information, have maybe different forms of knowledge. But with diverse agents, you will also have the problem that these diverse agents will produce diverse solutions, diverse suggestions, diverse informations. You need to aggregate them. You need to synthesize them into a global solution. During the process of synthesis, you have to be careful that what we typically see in groups, in people working together, that typically there will tend to be a bias. That means there usually are some people in the group who have more influence than others, and then the other people tend to conform to what those leaders say. So another important thing is that the agents should be able to work as much as possible independently. Of course, they can't work completely independently, because in the end, you need to aggregate their results, so there is a little bit of a tension between those two criteria. And finally, the criterion which I think is the most important in this talk, but which has not been developed well by Surowiecki, it's what he calls decentralization, or what I call distribution. That means that your different agents should be able to work as much as possible in parallel, independently, so that they can explore different aspects of the problem at the same time. And that is what I want to concentrate on. I want what I called an intelligent self-organizing system. And I not only use the term collective intelligence for that, I want to use an even more advanced term of distributed cognition. Distributed cognition, in contrast to collective intelligence, means that you don't just have lots of aunts that are almost the same, they have a little bit different knowledge and they all aggregate it. Distributed cognition is that where you really get specialized agents doing different things at different times, at different places, and still you manage to integrate the results. That's maybe a more realistic example than an ant society. That's an organization. Information comes in via different channels. It's distributed to different people, to different tools, to different sources of information. All that gets somehow processed, and at the end, some solution to the problem comes out. So that's a problem that has been studied, among others, in anthropology, where people have been analyzing these kind of organizations, and what they typically find is that it's not at all trivial. The very complicated things go on. But what we would like to do is to have this distributed cognition, which we know exists in the world, and our brain is another example of a distributed cognitive system, have this as possible self-organized. The idea of distributed cognition is that a complex problem cannot be solved all at once. It has to be decomposed into subproblems. Different subproblems are tackled by different agents, where ideally each agent tackles the problems he's best at, the problems he knows most about, and at the end somehow we get all the solutions together. And now we come to my major concept, coordination. We need coordinated action. The different agents working each on their part of the problem should do that in a way so that in the end, everything comes together nicely, efficiently, smoothly. Coordination, I will argue, contains at least four components: alignment, division of labor, workflow, and aggregation. The aggregation we have already spoken about. The alignment is the easiest part. Alignment is that part of self-organization which most people have in mind when they speak about self-organization. Alignment means that you have two agents that are working in such a way that they don't obstruct each other. They are synchronized, they are in sync, they are coherent, they are, we might say, working with a common intention. The opposite of alignment would be like you and I decide to move a heavy cupboard, and I push on this side and you push on the other side, and we're pushing in the opposite direction and nothing happens. That is not alignment. Alignment is we agree that we push at the same moment in the same direction towards the same goal. Then we are aligned and we can work together better. So another way of looking at alignment is that the agent work towards the same goal, speak the same language, refer to the same things, use the same standards. In the case of traffic, they drive on the same side of the road. In the case of technology, they use formats that are compatible. That's the process of alignment. Now, alignment in se is easy, or at least relatively easy. In self-organizing systems, there are many examples of that. What typically happens is you have two agents that start by doing things in a non-aligned way. The one performs an action that somehow disturbs the other responds by an action that maybe disturbs the first one. And like that, via trial and error, they try out lots of different actions until they find two actions that are consonant, that are aligned, and then they just continue. Once two agents are aligned, it becomes easier for a third agent to join the alignment, and the third is joined by a fourth, by a fifth, by a sixth. You get a nonlinear amplification, and typically the alignment spreads throughout the system, and it very quickly, the whole system gets aligned. An example that we discussed at the last research days was the fireflies synchronizing. Fireflies are aligned when they make light at the same moment, because then the whole signal becomes much more powerful. And there are some very simple mechanisms where each firefly slightly varies the moment at which it emits light. And when it's in sync with the other ones, it sticks. It keeps that alignment, and like that, the whole thing very quickly aligns. Another example I use all the time, it's magnetization. Here you have all kind of magnetic fields of different molecules. The material gets magnetized when all the molecules point in the same directions with their magnetic fields. And what happens typically is that all these two thermal fluctuations will move a little bit. As soon as two or three are aligned, they create a magnetic field that's a little bit stronger than their neighbors. So their neighbors will also tend to align, and very quickly the whole system gets aligned.
But they're quite homogeneous, so heterogeneity specialization does not...
Precisely. Alignment works well in the case of homogeneous system. Alignment, that is why alignment is the simplest form of self-organization. It creates homogeneity. Homogeneity may be necessary for some things. For example, when we are all talking, we should at least speak the same language. Heterogeneity is important as well, because if we all know the same things, there isn't much we have to speak about. ideally, we agree about the meanings of the words, but we may not agree about the content of what we're speaking about. So alignment is the simple form of self-organization. The other part of coordination can maybe best be explained with this little example. Suppose you're building a house. Suppose you have put the foundations, then you put the walls, then you put the roof. Once the roof is in place and the house is more or less safe from the elements, you can start putting electricity in the wall. You can also start putting tubes in the wall for plumbing. Those two activities can happen in parallel. You will have an electrician doing this thing at the same time a plumber is doing this thing at the same time in parallel. Once they have dug into the walls, put in cables, put in tubes, the walls are ready for plastering. Now the walls can be finished nicely with a coat of plaster. Once the coat of plaster is there, the walls can be painted. That is the order in which it has to happen. You cannot first paint and then plaster, or first plaster and then start destroying the plaster in order to lay electricity. So there's a sequential ordering, there's a certain sequence, and there's also a parallel order, things that happen at the same time. In the case of the parallel coordination, actually, we can subdivide it further into two aspects. I have a certain task, and then the next task will have to be divided over different agents. Like, let's say, if this task is finishing the roofing, now I can decide that here an electrician is starting to work, here a plumber is starting to work, here maybe somebody else is starting to work. That is what I call the division of labor. The task is decomposed into subtasks that can be performed simultaneously. That means that these are tasks that do not interfere with each other. It's a question of deciding who does what, allocating different parts of the task to different agents. The advantage is that we can now work with specialized agents who are very good at plumbing, very good at electricity. They don't need to know everything else. The second part of parallel coordination is that once I have subdivided the tasks, I again have to aggregate them. They have again to come together. The electricians and the plumbers, in the end, they are working on the same house, so it's their work, in the end, comes together in the same part. The problem of sequential coordination is what is often called workflow. Workflow is the idea work has to be done. It cannot all be done at the same time. It has to be done bit by bit, and if one agent has performed one part of the task, he passes it on to the next agent who then performs another part of the task, who passes it on to the next agent. For example, once the walls have been plastered, the task needs to be passed on to the painter, and now it's the job for the painter to finish the walls with a coat of paint. So sequential coordination is a question of ordering the tasks. That means if different tasks have to be performed that can't be done at the same time, deciding which first, which next, which third, and so on. So it's a question not only of who does what, but who does what at what moment. There is the ordering in there. So now I'm coming to the end of my talk. I have defined the problem of coordination. It's, I think, a very important problem. Can we find a self-organizing solution for that? How can we find a self-organizing mechanism that can tackle the problems of division of labor, aggregation, and workflow? The alignment, that part of the coordination, as I said, we know more or less how to do it. The alignment is the easy part. It's the three last part, division of labor, workflow, and aggregation that we need to solve. Now, I know of three self-organizing mechanisms that seem to be able to do these things at least to some degree. Stigmergy, Hebbian learning, and backpropagation. What is stigmergy? Stigmergy is that each agent works more or less independently. It performs part of the task, and whatever it has done, it puts back in a medium that is shared by all the agents. the agents look what's available in the medium. As soon as they recognize something that they can work on, they pick it up and they work on it. So it's a very simple, very easy way to work, and it solves all the problem of coordination. It's almost too good to be true. Hebbian learning, it's a generalization of the neural mechanism of the Hebbian mechanism, that is, if two things are active together at the same time, then they develop a kind of a stronger link. It's the idea that if two agents perform a work, the one soon after the other, or possibly at the same time, they develop some kind of a, what I might call a social relationship, so that next time they are more likely to work together. That's what happens in social networks. If you have been meeting somebody at a conference and you have worked with him for a couple of days at conference, you're more likely to work with him again in the future because you know each other, you have some habit, you have become maybe friends or at least acquaintances. That's the mechanism of Hebbian learning. It's a kind of a creation of a network of useful relationships. Finally, there is what I spoke about in the beginning, the idea of the backpropagation of rewards. If you do a task and you pass it on to a next agent and that agent rewards you for it, you will be more likely to next time again pass on a task to that same agent. That's a bit the mechanism in the market. You do a job, somebody pays you for it. If he pays you well for it, you're more likely to do a new job for that same person. If you sell something to a person who pays good money for it, you're more likely to sell to that same person. So how does Stigmergy tackle these problems of coordination? Well, the division of labor, it's very simple. All the tasks that are to be done are there available in the medium. Each agent just looks around, and when it recognizes something that it can do, it does it. The advantage is that you can normally expect that the most competent agents will do the right task because they will pick up the task they are good at. An example, my favorite example of Stigmergy is Wikipedia. Wikipedia is an incredibly complex system of knowledge with millions of pages on all possible subjects. Anybody can correct, edit any text in Wikipedia, but typically people will only correct something about the subject they know about. So you will normally not start editing a page about something that you have no idea about. So the division of labor is kind of spontaneous. The workflow is also spontaneous, because if I edit something in Wikipedia, there is a new version that is hopefully a little bit better than the previous version. If now somebody else after me reads what I have written and said, that's not bad, but he forgot to mention this aspect, that person will just add that aspect. So the workflow also is spontaneous. One part of the task is done, the next part of the task is done whenever somebody sees the occasion to do it. The aggregation is also trivial. In Wikipedia, how are the results aggregated? On the wiki website. The wiki website is there for everybody to see. All the results come together on that website, so aggregation is simple, it's trivial. So Stigmergy is, in a sense, a kind of a generic solution. It solves all these problems, but it solves them maybe not in the most efficient manner. Because I may put a new page in Wikipedia, but it can happen that only 6 months later, somebody by chance who knows something about the subject comes to that and says, but he has forgotten this important thing. So Stigmergy is very flexible. It can solve all these problems, but it doesn't do them in the most efficient way. So maybe Hebbian learning can be a little bit more efficient, but here already it's getting less obvious. The division of labor, in the case of neural networks, we have a little bit of a problem, like which neuron is going to deal with which aspects of the task. You can build neural networks that work, that function purely on the basis of Hebbian learning, that can do complex tasks like factor analysis, principal components analysis. But in order to do that, what you typically need to do is some kind of a lateral inhibition. That means if one neuron is active, it should somehow suppress activity in the other agents. That has the advantage that the different agents are kind of a little bit forced to specialize. If the one starts, for whatever reason, being active with one thing, he makes sure that the others are not active at the same time, and apparently neural networks that can help you to get this division of labor. The workflow, this is maybe most obvious in Hebbian learning. Hebbian learning, the rule is I am active. A little bit later, you are active on the same thing. We establish a relationship so that next time that I become active, you will already be waiting. You will already be ready to pick up the task from me. So the workflow, that's kind of the thing that is most obvious in Hebbian learning. And that's clearly how our brain does it. The aggregation is a little bit less obvious in neural networks. The aggregation means simply that you have certain neurons at the output layers that get input from many different places, and they somehow sum or aggregate that input. But it works well with neural networks where you have one-dimensional variables. It's not so obvious if it's more complex things. Finally, the last method of backpropagation, division of labor. Here the mechanism is, if you successfully perform the task, you will get a reward. Because of the rewards, you will become stronger. You will tend to get more and more of these tasks delegated to you. The reinforcement learning is basically that if you did it well, they will more quickly come back to you for the same kind of task. So here the division of labor is kind of spontaneous. If for whatever reason you happen to have done a particular task well, you will get more and more of these tasks delegated to you. Workflow, that's again a little bit less obvious, but inside the whole idea of backpropagation is this idea of ordering, of sequential ordering, one, next, third one, and so on. So I imagine that if the geometry is not fixed like in a neural network, but is more flexible like in the case of the classifier systems of Holland, still some form of workflow may emerge out of it. But I must say, I haven't thought about it deeply yet. And finally, aggregation is the same like in Hebbian learning. You will have some output agent that aggregates the results they get from all the previous ones. So coming to my last slide, the further I get into the talk, the more question marks there are. Can we integrate these different coordination mechanisms? I'll just give you three examples of systems I know that work, meaning engineered self-organizing systems. There are the classifier systems by John Holland. John Holland is the guy who invented the genetic algorithms, but his classifier systems are a more sophisticated version, you might say, but they have never really taken off. He already proposed it in 1986, the classifier systems. It's a very attractive system on paper. In practice, apparently, it doesn't solve the problems as smoothly as you would expect. But what classifier systems do, they use stigmergy and they use an equivalent of backpropagation. In a classifier system, a classifier is a kind of an elementary agent, very elementary, who takes some incoming information, transforms it into new information, and puts that information in what's called the message board. The message board is this kind of stigmergic medium where it can be picked up by other agents. Yeah.
So now this uses apparently two of the major methods that you have outlined previously. Now saying this is not working so well, what does it tell us?
The problem seems to be in the backprop. I have spoken with a specialist in classifier systems who couldn't tell me much except that the so-called bucket brigade algorithm, which is the equivalent of backprop, doesn't perform as well in general. It performs only in very specific cases. It seems to be more, I think the problem is more with the backprop than with the stigmergy. That's also one of the reasons why I put backprop at the end. It's the mechanism that for me is least obvious how it works. Stigmergy I'm pretty confident about. It works, it's just that it's not the most efficient solution. Another system that I don't know in detail, but I recently had a paper about it. It's called Jack in the Net. It's by a group of Japanese. It's a kind of a system for software agents, where software agents learn to collaborate with other software agents. They use an equivalent of the Hebbian algorithm in the sense that if two software agents have collaborated several times in the past, they will form what they call a grouping, so that next time that they get a task, they will immediately know who else to contact. They also have an equivalent of the backprop. That means that if the last agent delivers the service to the user and the user is happy with it, the user gives a reward, and that reward is then propagated back to the previous agent that helped the last agent to get that result. I don't know how well it works. The paper I read, even though I think it's about 5 years old, it only described some example situations. It didn't give any kind of a statistical analysis, so I have no idea how well that system works. Finally, a system that I know pretty well, that I think you all know pretty well, it's the ANT algorithms. Works with stig merge because the ANTs leave a trace, which is then elaborated by other ANTs. It also uses an equivalent of Hebbian learning in the sense that the trace goes from position A to position B. If many ANTs go from position A to position B, the connection between the two gets stronger, so you have something like Hebbian learning. So what does this suggest? That the ideal system maybe might combine all three mechanisms, stig merge, Hebbian learning, and back propagation. How would this ideal system work? I don't know yet. The only suggestion I want to add is that there exists a formalism that is called hypergraphs or hypernetworks that has the advantage that it allows both the flexibility of stig merge and the fixed geometry of a neural network. What you get in a hypernetwork is that instead of having a link connecting two agents, normally networks, a link is always a one-to-one connection. You have what is called hyperlinks, where a hyperlink has many components coming in and many components coming out. That hyperlink is like a kind of a meeting place. It's as if you have a bunch of agents that have a kind of a local medium where in which they deposit things, and then another bunch of agents takes things out of that local medium. So in that sense, at least formally, mathematically, it allows the combination of these three things. It allows a generalization of network and architecture, and it allows a generalization of a stigmergic architecture. So here it's become very tentative, but I think there is definitely potential there to explore and to develop more powerful generic methods.